Again, if we go back to the fly exhibition we had before, texts were this here. The text was projected on a bed, on a hospital bed, and to read it, people had to go to the end of the bed as you go to a patient in the hospital. It's the same position, you know, holding the end of the bed. This again gave a special feeling when you were discovering this text. So projecting just on a rug, it wasn't printed, it was just a projection. You can display text in space. Here, this was an exhibition about hens, and the hen ladders held the text. It's a bit small, but you can imagine that all texts are there. It was also an interesting way of setting up this display. And, oh, that's a little example passing by. Photographers dealing with the destruction of tropical forests in relation with the situation of great apes. And you can see that our designer splashed red paint, such as blood, across the whole wall, which increased very much the effect of these photographies. If we had them only, you know, alone, the impact would have been much smaller than, imagine a great wall splashed with blood. You can also make confrontation between 3D and 2D. This was an exhibition about the illusion of life and death. And we had these stuffed dogs watching a painting where a furious bull is running after a mother with child. But this was also an amusing installation where you combine 2D and 3D elements. Now, films. We often have films in exhibitions. And you can also stage the film itself. For instance, this was from the fly exhibition, showing the death of the agony of a fly. This was a film by a Swiss artist. And the surrounding we organized with, again, a few hundred thousand dead flies on the ground. It was easy to have them, as we had, you saw before the fly house. So, of course, we had the dead flies. Flies live approximately 10 days, 20 days, and as the exhibition lasted 1 year, we had very many flies. Another surrounding for this was a display already quite a long time ago, maybe 15 years ago, about carbon dioxide and in relationship with fossil fuel. Giving the difference between what is used in the third world and what is used in developed countries. So again, you see how the surrounding can be put in connection with a display. You see by the computer how old the exhibition was. And another case where the film was here, this was about rats and the fear about rats and horror films dealing with rats, with this kind of cage. Of course, we used cages as showcases for most things, and in this case, the showcase was lifted like a kind of psychoanalytical liberation. So you can do lots of things to put films in your display in particular ways. You can split films. This is also very efficient. Instead of having one long film, it can be very interesting to split films into various monitors. This was about hens and all stages between the killing of the hen and the wrapped up chicken. Here we had five monitors, but in a recent exhibition about evolution, and by discussing the evolution of tails, this was last year, we had 20 of these monitors around working simultaneously. And this is very interesting for visitors, because otherwise you would have 20 minutes films and dealing going this way. Am I short?
You've got about three minutes.
Okay, so I'll just accelerate a little slightly. What we are going through. Another technique you know well is paper ghost projection techniques, using semi-transparent mirrors. And you can also have projection on table. Here you have, we combine microscopes and moving images. This is film projecting on a table. I'll just check what I want to show you mostly, not to take too much time. Yes, maybe this one. It was a nice thing, too. This was a big sperm, 2 meter long, used as a screen to discuss evolution theory, you know, the gene, the selfish gene theory of Richard Dawkins. So a big element can be a very interesting screen, too. And then the last thing I want to speak about is how you can see actors, visitors as actors in the exhibition, because this is important. When you visit an exhibition, of course you look at the exhibition, but you look also at the other visitors, and they are in fact part of the exhibition. In this case, people were doing multiple choice tests under the eyes of these kind of priest and professor just looking down to them. So the visual impression was interesting for other visitors too. You can have people miming things in an exhibition. You can trap people in huge cages. This was in the rat exhibition. Unfortunately, there's no one in, but the effect was quite strong from away. Or, again, you can test your ability to use your arms for locomotion as great apes. And you can also test your facial expressions and compare your expressions with expressions of chimpanzees. So this was done through a half a semi-transparent mirror. So what the person didn't know that he was seen by the other visitors while he was doing this. He found that just only later, walking through the exhibition, seeing the next visitors going through. And again, when you have a show, it can be interesting to have the people watching themselves before watching the show. This was about the evolution of walking in on two legs, you know, for human and etc. And you can also join your face to the face of an ape using these transparent mirrors. We tested many situations and get this type of effect. And if we are speaking of the difference, the limit between man and ape, it's quite an efficient way to have people understanding that the difference is really very small. And we could make a hybrid between a visitor and a chimpanzee by dosing the light. And we could have 100% human and 100% chimpanzee and produce your own hybrid as you like. And I'll just conclude by saying that exhibitions need also, as music, as a symphony, needs an introduction and a conclusion, which often lack in exhibitions. This is important because when the visitor comes from the city, he is full of other ideas, and it takes a little time to catch his attention. This was an introduction to a dinosaur exhibition. This an introduction to an ape exhibition where a skeleton of a chimpanzee and of a man were just thinking over the future of the planet Earth. And this was for the sand exhibition. We had a sand flowing from the ceiling during the whole exhibition, and we ended up with something like 3 tons of sand largely going out of the central part where it should have stayed. And again, you need to conclude exhibitions. This was in the fly exhibition, the judgment of a fly. And after an hour and a half, people had to decide whether they wanted to kill the fly or to free the fly, and mostly they decided to free the fly. So this moment is also important at the end of an exhibition. It can be something more simple, well, not to organize, but for the feeling. This was by the same artist who did the cow installation. People could just go and rest under a group of sheep on the ceiling, and these sheep were moving, oscillating. So it was absolutely wonderful. And it was a great moment for the people, just after a long exhibition, to go and have a rest, and they loved this. So this was just to conclude, this was just to show that natural history museums can be often very dull and organized only according to systematics or ecology, but you can do much more to put natural history in the field of culture completely. Thank you.